हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल इजी डेंटिस्ट्री। फ्रेंड्स, आज हम पढ़ेंगे इनामल के बारे में। इसके पहले हमने डेवलपमेंट ऑफ टूथ ये टॉपिक डिटेल में पढ़ा है। इन दिस वीडियो वी वुड बी स्टडिंग अबाउट द जनरल फीचर्स ऑफ इनामल, वाइल द इन द अपकमिंग वीडियोस वी वुड बी स्टडिंग अबाउट द लाइफ साइकिल ऑफ अमीलोब्लास्ट एंड अमीलोजेनेसिस इन डिटेल। सो विदाउट वेस्टिंग एनी टाइम लेट्स बिगिन। इनामल इज अ मिराकल टिश्यू। How miraculous it is, let's see in detail. Now the enamel, it is the hardest structure present in the human body. It is the hardest structure and it covers the crown surface of the tooth, forming a resistive and protective covering. Now the maximum thickness of this enamel, it varies in various regions of the tooth. It is highest in the cusp region, which is 2 to 2.5 mm, while it is lowest in the cervical area of the tooth, which is just up a knife edge. Now the thickness of the enamel, it varies in various areas of the tooth, and also if we take into consideration the upper molar and the lower molar, if this is the upper molar, this is the lower molar, and this is the palatal cusp of the upper molar and this is the buccal cusp of the lower molar, we can see that the enamel is very, very thick than other parts of the crown in the palatal cusps of the upper molar and the buccal cusp of the lower molar. Why? So this is an adaptation to functional demands. What is the chief function of the tooth? The chief function of the tooth is mastication. When we masticate or chew the food, it is principally chewed between the palatal cusp of the upper molar and the buccal cusp of the lower molar. So in these cusps, the enamel thickness is higher than in the other region. Other properties, the specific gravity of enamel is 2.8. This question is asked in objectives, so please remember the specific gravity of enamel is 2.8. Now let's comment about the hardness of enamel. If it is the tooth covering with enamel, the hardness of the tooth, it is maximum in the cusp region and minimum in the cervical region. Also, as we approach from the surface to the core, the hardness of the enamel reduces. Then permeability of the enamel. The enamel, it acts as a semi-permeable structure. It allows certain ions and molecules to pass through it. Now let's see why some people have a perfectly white color of teeth while other have yellow. This color of enamel is determined by the calcification or the mineralized tissue present in the enamel. This mineralized tissue, it regulates the translucency of enamel and thus the color varies. Let's study this in detail. If a tooth has less level of calcification, then the enamel of that tooth is less translucent, as a result of which when light strikes the enamel, it reflects the color of the underlying yellow dentine, so the tooth appears yellow. On the contrary, if calcification level is high, then the translucency is also high and the yellow color of the dentine is not seen when the light strikes, so the teeth appears white. If we notice, some people have white teeth, but at the incisal or at the cervical area, there is yellowish tinge. What is the reason of this yellowish tinge? In this area of the tooth, the enamel is thin, as a result of which when light strikes this area of tooth, it reflects the color of the yellow dentine in the cervical area. And in some people, the teeth are white but the incisal edges have a bluish tinge. In these cases, the incisal edge is made up of only two layers of enamel and no dentine, as a result of which there is a bluish tinge to the incisal edge. Now let's study about the chemical properties of enamel, the miraculous chemical properties of enamel. What makes enamel the hardest structure of the body? Its inorganic content, which is 96%, and only 4% the organic structure and water. Now what is this organic structure, 4%? The organic material present in enamel composes of proteins. which are exclusive to the enamel and lipid. These proteins are of two types, the amylogenins and the non-amylogenins. The amylogenins contribute 90% of the enamel proteins, while non-amylogenins contribute 10%. The amylogenins are low molecular weight proteins, while the non-amylogenins are high molecular weight proteins. Amylogenins are rich in proline, histidine, glutamine, and leucine, while non-amylogenins are rich in glycine, aspartic acid, and serine. Some of the examples of non-amylogenins are enamelin, tuftalin, and amyloblastin. All these questions are asked in Viva, so students, please remember all this. Now let's study about the inorganic structure of enamel, which is 96%. Now, this 96% inorganic structure is in the form of hydroxyapatite crystals. These hydroxyapatite crystals, when viewed under cross-section, are hexagonal in shape. These hydroxyapatite crystals together form the enamel rods. When these hydroxyapatite crystals, we see the composition of it, the central portion of these crystals are rich in magnesium and carbonate. This richness of magnesium and carbonate makes the central part more acid soluble. That is, if this hydroxyapatite crystal is treated with acid, this inner portion gets dissolved soon. Also, we can see there are few water droplets or water molecules present in the hydroxyapatite crystals and around it. Now, the enamel rods. Enamel is made up of enamel rods or enamel prisms. The number of these rods vary in different teeth. In the lower lateral incisor, 5 million enamel rods are present, while in bigger tooth such as upper first molar, around 12 million of enamel rods are present. Let's comment about what is the length and diameter of these enamel rods. Now, the course of these enamel rods is not straight. It is tortuous, wavy, not straight. Okay? This tortuousness of the enamel rods make them longer than the thickness of enamel. The length of the enamel rod is more than the thickness of enamel. And we can also see that the enamel rods which are present in the cuspal area are longer than those present in the cervical area. How about the diameter of the enamel rod? The diameter of the enamel rod is also not the same throughout. It is less at the dentinal area, dentige, and it is more at the surface. This diameter increases from dege to the surface in a ratio of 1:2. For example, if the diameter of enamel rod is 1 micron at the dege, it doubles at the surface. That is, it becomes 2 at the surface. On an average, the diameter is 4 micrometer. Now, let's study the cross-section of these enamel rods. Mostly, they are hexagon, as we have seen. But in some cases, they may appear round, they may appear oval, they may appear arc-shaped. They may appear as fish scales. Sometimes they may also appear as keyhole shape. Let's study the ultrastructure of enamel. That is, when enamel is viewed under electron microscopy, how does it look? The enamel rod's shape can be well appreciated as keyhole shape when viewed under electron microscopy. If any enamel rod is cut in longitudinal section along the length and viewed under electron microscopy, the sections pass through the head of one row of rod and the tails of the another row of rod, which give rise to the keyhole appearance. This part of the keyhole is called as the body and this is called as the tail. Now, let's study about the striation of enamel rods. If the enamel rods are cut longitudinally, if the enamel rods are cut along its length and viewed underground section, we can appreciate that there are striations which are present on the enamel rods. There are striations which are present on these enamel rods. These are at an average distance of 4 microns from each other. What is the relevance of these striations present on the enamel rods? They represent the rhythmic pattern of enamel formation. Rhythmic pattern of enamel formation. And there is also some diurnal variation in enamel deposition. The rate is different in the daytime. The rate is different at the night time. This is called as diurnal variation. And these striations are more visible when the section is treated with acids. Now, what are the directions of rods? The direction of enamel rods is different in deciduous teeth and permanent teeth. In the occlusal toothed, the direction is same. That is, it arises from the DEJ, runs a wavy course and ends on the enamel surface. In the cuspal area, they are almost vertical. And in towards the middle of the crown, they become horizontal. But in the cervical area, the direction of rods is different. In deciduous teeth, they retain their horizontal course, while in the permanent teeth, they turn in an apical direction towards the root apex. These rods have wavy course, and we can describe this in a small example. If the middle part of the crown is divided into thin horizontal disc, as shown here. If it is divided into thin horizontal disc, the rods in adjacent disc, they turn in opposite direction. For example, rod in one disc start from DEJ, run an oblique course and turns towards the right, while in the adjacent disc, it turns towards the left. Now, let us study one more important terminology, that is called, what is gnarled enamel? This question is very frequently asked in YY and students get confused with it. Remember, gnarled enamel is an optical appearance. First answer you should give, it is an optical appearance. If the enamel is cut in oblique plane, at the cuspal region near the dentine, if this section is viewed, the rods in this section seems to be more intermingled or intertwined between each other, giving an irregular appearance. This is irregularly looking enamel is called as the gnarled enamel, and it is an optical appearance. What is Hunter-Schrager bands or the HS bands? Now, we have seen that there is change in the direction of rods. This change in direction of rods is responsible for the appearance of these Hunter-Schrager bands. It is best seen when the tooth is cut in its longitudinal section. If the tooth section is made in its longitudinal section, ground section is made and viewed under oblique reflected light. What we see is that there are these alternating dark and light bands which originate at the DEJ, pass outward and end some distance from the outer enamel. These are alternate dark and light bands are called as Hunter-Schrager bands. Now, what causes this dark and light bands? The dark bands appear when the enamel rods are cut in longitudinal section, and light bands appear when the enamel rods are cut in transverse section. These dark bands are called as the parazones, while the light bands are called as the diazones. These are the alternating dark and light bands of the Hunter-Schrager. There is an angle between this parazones and diazones, which is 40 degree. This is also an important multiple choice question. Now, why these HS bands appear? There are three school of thoughts. Some scientists, they feel that there is variation in calcification of the enamel which causes these Hunter-Schrager bands. Second, scientists think that there is difference in permeability and composition of the enamel matrix which causes these HS bands. But the third and the most widely accepted theory is that there is change in direction of rods which causes these Hunter-Schrager bands. Now, incremental lines of Retzius, the last topic for today, or the stri of Retzius. What are incremental lines of Retzius? These are the lines which represent the incremental pattern of enamel growth. The enamel is laid down in layers, and these incremental lines, they represent the incremental pattern of enamel growth. These lines may be hypomineralized or they may be hypermineralized. Now, how do they appear under microscope? When viewed under longitudinal section, they appear as brown bands which appear near the cusp of dentin. In the cervical area, they run obliquely and deviate occlusally. They arise at the DJ and deviate occlusally. In transverse section, we can see them as concentric circles. Now, what is the daily rate of enamel formation? It is 3.5 micron. It increases from inner to outer enamel. This rate increases from inner to outer enamel. The evenly spaced stri of Retzius show a 6 to 11 day rhythm. Moderate amount of incremental lines of Retzius are considered normal, but stress and metabolic disturbances may cause a disturbance in these stri of Retzius, making them more broadened. So in this lecture, we have studied about the various structures of enamel, and in the next lecture, we'll be studying about enamel cuticle, lamella, tufts in detail, and also various age changes in enamel. Friends, if you like the video and find it helpful, please subscribe to our channel and please share the knowledge with all your friends. Easy Dentistry is all about helping you to learn dentistry very easily and make you find interest in it. Please share the video, friends. You are just a click away to learn. Please subscribe to Easy Dentistry. That's all for today. Bye for now. Thank you.